Hey there, welcome to Church at Home for another Sunday. It's the 17th of May, and I'm really glad that you could join us this morning. I hope and pray that you have a sense of blessing from our service today. I hope that as you worship with us, as we sing these songs in the next few moments, that you will really feel a sense of God's presence with you in your home. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you that in the midst of all of the chaos and confusion, all of the uncertainty, we know that we can come to you and find in you the certainty and the hope and the peace and the joy and the love that our hearts need so much. God, you are worthy of all of our praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Give and take away my heart. I am Begin by asking you a couple of questions. What do you know about heaven? And more importantly, do you hope to go to heaven when you die? These questions have intrigued humans for thousands of years. The Bible provides some answers to these questions, and I would like to share one with you this morning. It comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 13. Here Jesus tells the parable of the merchant looking for pearls. The kingdom of heaven is like a merchant looking for fine pearls. When he had found one of great value, he went away, sold everything he had, and bought it. Notice that the kingdom of heaven pays the ultimate price for the pearl. We are the rough diamonds, and in this case, the pearls. And God was willing to allow his only son, Jesus, to be crucified on a Roman cross about 2,000 years ago to buy us back. Christians who put their belief and acceptance in what Jesus has done are well on the way to the kingdom of heaven. Isaiah the prophet puts it this way in chapter 43. But now, this is what the Lord says. He who created you, Jacob, he who formed you, Israel, don't fear, I have redeemed you, I have bought you, and you are mine. Those who put their trust in Christ have a wonderful future in the kingdom of heaven. I'd invite you now to spend a few moments reflecting on and meditating on the sacrifice that Jesus has made for each of us.
Today in the book of Matthew chapter 10 that we're calling Sent, where Jesus sends out his disciples and they become his apostles. We're looking today at verses 9 to 15, and Jesus gives an answer to what we might consider a frequently asked kind of question. What if it doesn't work? Matthew chapter 10, starting at verse 9. Do not get any gold or silver or copper to take with you in your belts. No bag for the journey or extra shirt or sandals or a staff, for the worker is worth his keep. Whatever town or village you enter, search there for some worthy person and stay at their house until you leave. As you enter the home, give it your greeting. If the home is deserving, let your peace rest on it. If it is not, let your peace return to you. If anyone will not welcome you or listen to your words, leave that home or town and shake the dust off your feet. Truly I tell you, it will be more bearable for Sodom and Gomorrah on that day of judgment than for that town. You might remember that when we introduced this series a couple of weeks ago, we looked at John chapter 20, verse 21, and we saw there Jesus say to his first apostles, "As the Father has sent me, so I am sending you." And we need to acknowledge that these instructions that Jesus gives his disciples as he sends them, as he makes them into his apostles, his sent ones, these instructions apply to us as well as to them, that we also, like them, are sent. And the first thing he says to them is that you don't need any special equipment. You don't need a whole lot of backing. You don't need a whole lot of finance. There's not some certain type of technology or hidden knowledge that you need to have. Simply go with these instructions. So when I go out, I like to be prepared. Normally, there are times when I take a risk and just head out and see what happens. But usually when I'm going out, I've got two things in particular. WD-40 and duct tape. They say if it's moving and it shouldn't be, duct tape solves it. If it's not moving and it should be, WD-40 solves it. As long as I've got those two things, I reckon I'm pretty right. There are other times when I'm on my motorbike, I make sure I've got my multi-tool with me. I make sure I've got all of the things that I think I might need just in case something happens. I try to be prepared. I try to be in control. The question here that Jesus wants to put into the minds of his followers, his disciples, his apostles, is this: who or what are you trusting? What are you placing your trust in if something goes wrong? Maybe for you and I, it is our insurance. Maybe it's in our maintenance schedule or the regular servicing we have of our vehicles. Maybe it's in your security system at home or the way that you lock up your house. We surround ourselves with a whole bunch of different methods and means to try and help ourselves have a sense, have a feeling of control in this life. But what we need to recognize is that that feeling, that sense of control that we feel we might have is false. That we actually don't have any sense of control. And so when we begin to feel like we're out of control, we don't know what to do. We fall apart. When all along we never had control anyway. The question remains, who or what are you putting your trust in as you go out on the mission that God sends you on? And Jesus is quite clearly saying to his followers, to his disciples, as you go, don't take extra money and don't acquire, it says in some versions, don't acquire extra money for your journey. Just go, because the worker is worth his wages. Now we keep coming back to this first prayer that Jesus invites us to pray that he mentioned back in chapter 9. He says, ask the Lord of the harvest to send workers out into his field. And then in these verses, just three or four verses later, Jesus is sending his disciples out. So who's paying the wages here? Whose workers are we? There's no suggestion here that the people whose homes we go to are the ones who are responsible for providing for us, although there is a sense in which that may and probably can and will happen. The truth, though, is that we are God's workers. This is his harvest field, and he is the one who provides. He is the one who pays the wages. So when Jesus says you don't need a whole bunch of financial backing, you don't need some kind of system behind you, he's saying, trust God. You're his worker. This is his work. He will look after you. So as you step out with a heart to reach people with the good news of the kingdom of heaven, who are you trusting? Where is your trust placed? And what is helping you overcome the fears that you have in stepping out and sharing this good news with your friends and family and neighbours? Perhaps a knowledge of the fact that this is God's work, that this is his harvest field, and that he will provide for you, he will care for you, he will look after you. Perhaps those things might help you as you challenge yourself to step out in faith and share this good news with your loved ones. There's also a really clear message here about not getting rich from the good news. The kingdom of heaven is not for sale. As it says in verse 8 that we looked at last week, it is freely given and freely received. And the money that Jesus is talking about here in verse 9, that's not just about money that we think we might need for ministry purposes. It's also warning us away from trying to make money to get rich from the kingdom. Jesus says no to both of these. There's a really important message here for us as well. And the message is this. You know, insurance is okay. It's fine to have security features on your home and your car. And we've got to be wise. We've got to be aware that there are people in our world, unfortunately, who want to take things that are not theirs. There are accidents that happen. There are incidents that happen. And having things like insurance and security features are not bad. We need to be good stewards of the things that God has given us. But in reality, it is not those things that make us secure or that keep us secure. It is not those things that give us any kind of sense of control. Remember, we don't have any control, but God is always in control. And it is in him that we find our security. Some of the ladies in our church have shared with me their favourite saying, let go and let God. And there's another great saying that I love, an old one that I can't quote the author for you because I don't know who originally said it, but it goes like this, God's will shall never take you where God's hand will not also provide for you. God's will never take you where God's hand can't provide for you. The greatest peace, the greatest freedom and sense of empowerment in ministry and mission that we can find is when we let go and let God. When we take our hands off any kind of controls and attempts to manipulate or make people do what we think they should do or need to do or what we want them to do, and simply allow the one who has always been in control to be in control. So what does he mean by this bit in verses 11 to 13? Verses 11 to 13, it says, whatever town or village you enter, search there for some worthy person and stay at their house until you leave. As you enter the home, give it your greeting. If the home is deserving, let your peace rest on it. If it is not, let your peace return to you. We need to recognize that there are people who do not call themselves Christians who are vital to the growth of God's kingdom in our world. People who do not yet know Jesus, who may or may not ever accept Jesus as their Lord and Savior, and yet who are vital to the growth of his kingdom in our world. Neil Cole is a church planter who has planted thousands and thousands of churches all through Europe. And among other things, one of the things he says he would do differently if he had his time again would be to begin his church plants in the homes of non-Christians. You and I need to be people who are known and who are happy to be known and to know our neighbours. In the streets and suburbs where we live, we need to be peace givers, peace bringers. And so when we meet a neighbour, when we go into a friend's home, do we bring peace? Do we bring a greeting that is a peaceful place, a peaceful greeting for that person, for that person's place? And where we bring that greeting of peace, that foretaste of God's kingdom to that home, to that person, do they accept it? The truth is that that person of peace who responds in kind to our greeting of peace, whose home is open to accepting and receiving that peace that we bring, they might not be easy to find. We may need to search for those people. And yet when we do, Jesus' instruction is that we stay with them. We stay with them. We allow his kingdom to grow like a mustard seed grows, a tiny little glimmer of faith in that person's home, to let it grow and become what it can become in that person's home, in that person's life. It may be that as time goes on, that person leads many more to Christ than you or I ever could. We just don't know. Our task is simple. We need to submit ourselves to the work of God in our lives, to allow his will to be done in our lives as it is done in heaven. And then, as Michael Frost says, we need to be about alerting people to the universal rule and reign of Jesus, the universal rule and reign of God through Jesus Christ. That's our task. And there's a very simple way to put that, another way to put that that you've heard many times. Love the Lord your God with all of your heart and all of your soul and mind and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. This is the simplicity of this whole Christian thing, or at least our part of it, that we simply love God, we do what he tells us to do, we say and do the things we see Jesus saying and doing, and we love our neighbour as ourselves. We alert them to the universal rule and reign of God through Jesus. So the question remains, what if it doesn't work? What if it doesn't work? In verses 14 and 15, Jesus says this. Verses 14 and 15. If anyone will not welcome you or listen to your words, leave that home or town and shake the dust off your feet. Truly I tell you, it will be more bearable for Sodom and Gomorrah on the day of judgment than for that town. It seems like Jesus is actually expecting that there will be times and instances where it won't work. Where however much heart you or I have for the people that we are speaking to about Jesus, however much information or however intelligent our arguments might be, it just won't work. These people might just not ever accept the good news about Jesus. He speaks about dust here in the same way that we read about dust in Genesis. In Genesis chapter 3, it says this in verse 19. Genesis 3, verse 19. By the sweat of your brow you will eat your food until you return to the ground, since from it you were taken. For dust you are, and to dust you will return. We're dust. And I guess in times in the past, I've read that passage, and I've read this passage that talks about shaking the dust from our feet, and I've felt like it's somehow an insult. Somehow we're being told we're nothing but dirt. And yet, what Jesus is saying is very different from that. When we return to dust, when our bodies pass away, we go to our Father. And in the same way that we hand off the work that Jesus has handed to us, we hand these people, this dust, back to God. We take our hands off, acknowledging that we can't control these people. And we place them back into the hands of the one who is in control, the one who knows everything. We allow the work that God has given us to do to continue to be his work, regardless of the outcomes that we might hope for or wish for. And the last bit of this passage that we have before us today is the hard bit. It's the bit that I want to preach about less than anything. It's the bit where Jesus says that there is a day coming where those who have the information about Jesus and choose not to accept this good news will face judgment. And it breaks my heart, and I know it breaks so many of your hearts as you pray day after day for your loved ones, for your family, your friends and your neighbours, as you've tried time and time again to share with them the good news that Jesus loves them, that he has prepared a place in heaven for them if they will only accept his offer. Jesus says that there will be times when it won't work. What do we do if it doesn't work? I believe the instruction here is actually for our benefit, as well as for the benefit of the people that we love, that we're trying to reach with the good news. The worst thing that we can do in so many cases is just to keep beating people to death with the good news. Jesus says, if you have given your greeting of peace, if you have shared this great good news of the kingdom of heaven with these people, and the peace doesn't rest with them, then allow it to come back to you. Leave that person in my hands, Jesus is saying. Leave them in my hands. We need to trust that the Lord of the harvest knows what he is doing. That as we pray for him to send workers out into his harvest field, and as we answer the call and answer that prayer by going with the good news of the kingdom of heaven and sharing the love of Jesus with our family and with our friends and neighbors, that God knows what he is doing. And if the peace that we offer them, if the good news that we offer them doesn't remain with them, if they don't accept that, then sometimes the best thing we can do is to simply allow that peace to return to us and to care for someone else. Doesn't mean we have to reject that person or neglect them in prayer, but simply trust that the Lord of the harvest is in control. So what is our task? What is our task? To pray to the Lord of the harvest to send workers into his field. And then to go. To share the good news of the kingdom of heaven. This is God's harvest. And as we work in his fields, let us trust him. We don't know who is ready to accept the good news when we share it. And maybe the person we're sharing it with isn't ready. And we don't know if God won't bring along someone after us at just the right time to bring the fruit of his harvest into his storehouse. As we wrap the service up today, let me encourage you to remember these two things. Firstly, let's submit ourselves to God and to his will, allowing his will to be done in our lives as it is in heaven. And in so doing, loving him with all of our heart and soul and mind and strength. And let us love our neighbour as ourselves by alerting them to the universal rule and reign of God through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just praise you that you are so faithful, that your love for people is so great. Lord, we thank you that we have received your love. We have been recipients of your goodness and your grace. And daily, in so many ways, we experience your mercies new every morning. Lord, help us to trust you as we step out on mission for you. Help us to not neglect the call to answer the prayer that you would send out workers into your harvest field, but instead help us to step out and to trust you with the results. Lord, you call us to be faithful to you, to remain in you, to abide in you, and you have promised us that through that, fruit will grow, that people will come to know you as Jesus is lifted up in our lives. So God, help us to be faithful. And we pray that through our lives, through our work, many people will come to know you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in his love for me. Who is love for me? Who the sun sets free? Oh, is free. I am who you say I am. I am who you say I am.
Service has been a blessing to you. I want to invite you to join us for morning tea right now. Again, still on your computer, please click the link in the comment below and join us in our Zoom meeting for morning tea. It would be great to see your faces and hear your voices. So please click on that link. And if you're having any trouble there, just drop a comment saying, please help me, and we'll get in touch and figure out how to help you become a part of that growing little group of people who are enjoying spending some time together after our services on Sunday mornings. We have a groundskeeper position available, a casual groundskeeper position, and our recent groundskeeper has obtained a full-time job for himself, which we're very excited for him in that regard. If you would like to apply for the position, please send your cover letter and resume to the church office by 25th of May. If you would like to apply for that or know someone who would, please give them the advertisement which is in our church newsletter. We're also still looking for volunteers for Backyard Basement. The store, the op shop, Backyard Basement, has been closed during the coronavirus retail lockdown restrictions. However, restrictions are slowly lifting and the store has now been able to reopen. Store hours are also changing. The store will now be open from Tuesday to Saturday, and the hours are 8:30 to 3:30. So we encourage you to head down there, see if there's anything that you might need for winter, some winter gear maybe, and see if there's some hours that you can give each week or even every couple of weeks to help the store out. The profits that are made at the Backyard Basement are given away. They're not kept by the church, but given away to various needs and supporting various aspects of our community here in Withcott and wider as well. So please consider volunteering at Backyard Basement. That'd be great. As restrictions are lifting, we're also able to have 5 visitors in our home. And so we want to encourage you to consider whether or not your life groups are something that you want to reconvene. And if you would like some help with that, we also encourage you to call the church office and I'll have a chat with you, or I'll put you onto Anne, our Life Groups Coordinator. One of the things we're hoping to do in the coming weeks, we've got about 2 months left, according to the latest advice from the government, before we can begin to gather together in the building here for church on a Sunday morning with up to about 100 people. What we are allowed to do at this stage is to have gatherings of no more than 10 people. And so what I'm offering to do, if you would like to do, is to run small communion services. If you would like to come into the church at some point during the week and share communion with a few of your brothers or sisters in Christ, then I will lead those times. We might sing a song or two and share communion together. So if you would like to do that, please call the church office. You can leave a message on the answering machine there or speak to Miley or myself if we're in the office. Our current office opening hours are Tuesday and Friday from 9 till about 4. So please contact us if you would like to come and share in communion in a small group in that way. That'd be great. And as I mentioned, at this stage, if all goes well, the date that we are looking forward to, where we can all gather back together, is the 17th, I believe, of July. 17th of July. So if that's a Sunday, then that's the date we're looking for. I hope and pray, and I ask you to pray along with us, that Australia will remain healthy, that we will continue to see the coronavirus cases, the numbers drop, that more and more people will recover, those who have contracted the virus, that we will see no more new cases, and that there will be no more deaths. And then with that, along with that, we just long for, we look forward to gathering together with you all here on a Sunday morning, hopefully in mid-July. So thanks again for joining us this morning. I hope that you will join us in our Zoom morning tea meeting in just a moment. Thanks again. See you later. Blah, 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 blah.